So is Bitcoin the future of money? That's what we're going to discuss here. After this session, we're going to discuss the future of money in its entirety. But Bitcoin, in short, can indeed become the future of money because it can do things other types of money can't. We will explain how this works. So very first slide, you already see what we've discussed before, that something historically evolves into eventually a unit of account slash medium of exchange. So first of all, it starts as a collectible, a rarity that people that's difficult to collect and that people really want to collect, as Bitcoin started as well. Then it becomes a store of value because people are start to value it and actually exchange stuff for it. So that's what's currently happening. That's currently the phase that Bitcoin needs to evolve as well. It also needs to be technical possible. And as mentioned before, that's currently they're currently working very hard to make it more scalable, to make it more friendly, etc., etc. All the things that need to be there for adoption. After that, after it has proven itself over a certain amount of time, which, for example, took the plastic cards, so the debit and credit cards, took multiple decades of years, multiple, I think even credit cards took 50 or 60 years to get into main circulation. But of course, thanks to the internet, we have now faster communications, etc. So Bitcoin will most likely do this a lot faster than the credit cards did, luckily. Eventually, resulting in a medium of exchange where people are start to exchange Bitcoins or Satoshis among each other. So currently we're talking about Bitcoins consisting of 100 million Satoshis, but eventually we will, by my expectation, start talking about Satoshis and we start exchanging Satoshis to Satoshis. So not anymore Satoshis to what? So the store of value there in that case is not measured in dollars anymore. And I think it will eventually be frowned upon. So why should you measure it in dollar when you can actually exchange it and earn it and spend it in Satoshis? There's no need to exchange it anymore to any other fiat currencies. And in my honest opinion, I think that fiat currencies will f*** this up on their own. So they will eventually leave the stage and other forms of more centralized and digital currencies like the central bank digital currencies will replace them. And I think that's also the moment when people start realizing what Bitcoin can actually encompass, a decentralized deflationary model of money. So currently there's somebody walking in the studio, sorry for that one. We've put up a huge sign, don't enter, and still people enter. So it happens, we will cut it out or we won't. Bottom line here is that it's non-correlated with other types of assets. So whether it's a unit of account or a medium of exchange, if you measure it in dollars, of course, it currently fluctuated. If you measure it in pesos, like mentioned before, it fluctuates in a different direction. You need to figure out a way, how are we going to measure it? If you relay it to other financial products, like for example, derivatives, it has a different direction. So for example, if the market goes down, Bitcoin can go up and in the other way around, which makes it a very interesting tool of investment as well, part of a store of value strategy. So sum it up, currently it resides in the store of value and it is flirting a bit with medium of exchange. But to get to medium of exchange, it needs to improve regarding the purchase of power, store of value, and it needs to improve in other adoptiveness properties like being scalable, being user friendly, etc. So why Bitcoin is an interesting store of value, as mentioned before, it's deflationary. The supply is limited and you can't alter the amount of Bitcoins eventually. There are 21 million Bitcoins. By current estimation, already 25% is lost. As mentioned, remember the user friendliness. Not so very user friendly if you use your Bitcoins, because people have lost their private keys in the beginning, of course, mainly when it was quite easy to mine and gain a lot of Bitcoins. It was also, and nobody was certain what it's going to be. It was also very easy to lose your keys. We all know famous stories about people throwing out hardware on huge e-waste, etc. Right? So I think there's even a guy losing 7,500 Bitcoins because he needed to throw away his mining rig because his girlfriend was complaining because it made a lot of sound. And I think those, I don't know if you've ever heard of mining rig, but indeed it is a valid complaint. So it's deflationary instead of where fiat is inflationary. And approximately by the end of 2040, 99.9% is mined. By the end of 2140, 100% is mined. So whether it's a bubble, whether it isn't a bubble, bottom line here is, it basically, it is a bubble and it isn't a bubble. So it popped 7 or 8 times before, but it keeps on coming back because in the end, it is actually the next evolution in sending money, in recording value of transactions. As mentioned before, we are migrating towards a more interconnectivity, and basically these new type of ledger, which is really hard to attack and to kill, makes it that people start believing in it more and more and actually start using it for different use cases. First use case up, of course, is money. In the slide, you see the comparison because not backed by gold, backed by math, etc. You can read this on your own. We've discussed this a dozen times, so not worth investigating. What I want to show you, though, is the different bubbles there are. Important to realize that money is always in a bubble because money is a human institution. And human institutions evolve over time, of course, and evolve based upon the society. So basically, to ask yourself the question whether Bitcoin is a bubble, it all depends on the time frame or the moment in time where you currently are. So as we've seen, the price of Bitcoin was in dollars measured, was a bubble in the end of 2017. But if you compare that price, for example, with the price of 10 years from now, it might be actually undervalued. But in that moment in time, yes, it was most certainly indeed a bubble. As has been shown many times before in the next slide, I've stated four interesting bubbles. I think there are approximately 7 or 8 bubbles which went before the last bubble in November, where Bitcoin devaluated with at least 80 or 90%. So if something drops by price with 90%, I think it's fair to state that it was indeed in a bubble. But of course, every 10 minutes, the heart keeps on pounding. So anytime the trust keeps on building, the technical properties keep improving, adoption increases, ecosystem grows, etc., etc. It keeps getting stronger and stronger. And therefore, I mentioned before, it needs time to prove itself. And you will see by next generations, which are of course a lot more adaptive toward new forms of money, because for them it's just money as they know it, they will most likely be the ones that actually start measuring in satoshis instead of old fiat money. For example, they just don't remember what fiat money is, or they might not even have a bank account. I sincerely doubt whether my twins of 3 years old will have a bank account when they are 18. I don't think their bank account will look the way they currently have, because Bitcoin eventually offers to be your own bank. So Bitcoin is too volatile. Next slide. It all depends on how you measure it. I think if you measure it in a global purchase power, I don't think it's actually in a bubble, because like countries in Turkey, Venezuela, etc., you see the purchase power increasing hugely, just like in India a few years ago when they announced the note, the 20 rupee note there. It all depends on perspective, which region are you in, which time frame are you in, and of course in the use case. Because what are you using Bitcoin for? If you're using it for money, okay, then there is a certain equilibrium. But if you start using it for different forms, different things other than money, if you solve the money application, then it will have a different user base, different adoption rate, different use cases. The demand increases, of course, and then most likely the price will increase as well, because basic economics, if demands increase, probably most likely the price as well, if the amounts of Bitcoins are fixed. So, also, an often heard argument is in the next slide that the transaction fees are too high. Yes, and I hope they will always be of a certain amount. Of course, because we need to incentivize miners. If the transaction fees are very slow or very low, we need to have accomplished a huge amount of transactions per block. perfectly fine as well, but we still need to pay miners. If we have free transactions on a Bitcoin network, that means that the security is arranged in a different setting, of course, because proof of work requires energy, requires money investment. So you need to compensate for that. So you need to have either a different consensus algorithm or a weak security there. So transactions fees are indeed present, of course, way less than when you are currently intercontinental transacting money, but of course, way too high if you're buying a cup of coffee. So it all depends on how are you going to use Bitcoin in the future. Are you going to use it on a day-by-day basis to actually pay for your groceries? Yes, then it most definitely needs to go down a notch regarding the transaction fee. And of course, if you're comparing it with a transactional cross-border reference, for example, my colleague who comes from Cameroon often sends his mother to Cameroon money, used to do this by, I think, Western Union, paid 10 to 15% of fee, now can do this for 10 to 15 cents per transaction. She receives it within 10 to 20 minutes. She doesn't need to go to the Western Union and stand in a line. He doesn't need to go to Western Union and stand in a line. They don't pay the transaction fee. They don't know your data. And eventually, she only needs to return it there to their local currencies. And hopefully, in the future, she doesn't even need to do that because people start trusting it. And in that case, 10 to 15 cents is not a lot of money. But also very important here is to realize that although you as an end user might think that your transaction is free when you buy a cup of coffee, it truly is incorporated in the price because the merchant, in this case, the guy or girl making your coffee, pays the transaction fee of the five intermediaries that are between you and the coffee guy, right? So it's not you to coffee guy. No, it's you, intermediary, 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 coffee guy. These five intermediaries not only see all your data, they also ask a certain fee, of course. So eventually you will end up paying 2 to 3% per transaction, which you as a user don't see, but as a merchant, of course, see it. So it is a cost of a merchant. And how do merchants cover their costs? Of course, by increasing the price. So eventually you end up by paying more by using the current banking system. But of course, you as a user don't experience it this way, but you will see as soon as everybody in the world starts using, for example, a decentralized network, which is peer-to-peer, the transaction costs will actually decrease on the merchant side. And the merchant, of course, it all depends on the type of merchant, is now able to either have a bigger margin or reduce the price a bit and let you enjoy this increasing of cost efficiencies as well. Important to realize that although you think it is free to swipe your card, you're transferring data, you're paying 2 to 3% incorporated in the price, and you're basically, as Antonopoulos beautifully said, slowly killing democracy. But for that, I will refer you to another movie. We will upload it in one of the short side clips. Also, on a final note here, is that Bitcoin enabled huge amounts of other currencies. As you may have already noticed, is that we often focus on Bitcoin. Of course, there are many other cryptocurrencies out there as well, and we will discuss all of them in later sections. But this open form of competition, this open form of open sourceness, I don't know if that's a verb, but basically, it's a zoo out there. Everybody is competing with each other and everybody is trying to figure out the new Bitcoin. In my honest opinion, that's quite a difficult one. Try to copy-paste an ecosystem that Bitcoin has, for example. And basically, what is Bitcoin? Is Bitcoin Bitcoin Core, Bitcoin Cash, Bitcoin Diamond, Bitcoin Jesus, Bitcoin SV? Or is Bitcoin all of these different types of Bitcoin and does it just represent different choices? Basically, we now have the freedom as an end user to choose one of these cryptocurrencies. So it's a more of a Hayekian, referred to a former economist. He described that by creating currency to open markets or let the choice of let people choose their own currency, basically demands what currency is the best one. So if people want to use Bitcoin Cash, they can use Bitcoin Cash. If Bitcoin Core offers a better store value, they pick Bitcoin Core. Let the market decide. So it's one big ass Hayekian experiment here. For the very first time in human history, we now have a lot of options. And of course, with a lot of options comes a lot of responsibility as you as an end user. And eventually time will tell, the strongest will survive, or perhaps as some claim, is it actually the strongest or is it the best marketed, etc. The beauty here is everything is transparent. We see and learn everything. We see everything, we learn from each other. And it's a very, very interesting time for us money freaks to be around in, because for the first time, we actually separate state and money just as they separated church and money. So for that, I want to invite you in the very final session before we went in, before we go to the smart contracting. This new session is going to be a philosophical one. I will stop the jibber jabber. See you there.